shoes. I want some. I know. How cool would those be with my socks? Just have to say, in case any of you are wondering, Andrew by far has the coolest shoes on today. Oh, Darren, no, yours are nice. No, 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 his are studly. They are cool. Nice, yeah, oh, I want a pair. Too cool. Can you imagine that, like, during communion? I could tap out something, it'd be kind of cool. Anyway, focus, Sawyer, focus. Okay, good morning.
Good morning.
Try that again, good morning.
Good morning.
Good to hear that you're all here. Anybody have a birthday since I saw you last? That doesn't seem very excited. I might have missed that if I didn't know who you were. Has anybody had a birthday? You've had a birthday? Really? So what happens when you have birthdays? You lose your speech? Well, do you want something? You lose your speech?
No, I don't.
I didn't think you did. I lived with you. Would you like a sucker? There we go. See, when you have your birthday, his birthday was last week, right? When was your birthday? It was like yesterday. Yeah, that's the word. That's the word, yesterday. There you go. You'll get that vocabulary word sometime this year. When you have a birthday, if I haven't seen you since then, you get a sucker on your birthday, so keep coming back. So you could get a sucker, you could get double parties, hint, hint. All kinds of good stuff happens here at church. Okay, let's see, I need a volunteer. Who trusts me? God, keep all your hands down. I can pick on mine, because you probably won't call some child agency when it's my kid. Okay, I'm holding him hostage. Someone needs to come and rescue him. You gonna come? He needs your help, because he can't get out. No, I got him back. He's still not free yet. What did Darren just do? He just rescued you? How many of you have ever needed help from somebody? How many of you ever needed help from somebody? Sometimes you get stuck maybe on a math problem at school and you need help from a friend or a teacher, or maybe you get yourself in trouble and you need help from maybe a mom and dad to help you figure it out. How many of you are sometimes afraid to ask for help? Put your hands up. Yep. I hear you. High five with that. I am too. Sometimes we're afraid. Sometimes teachers are mean and scary. You're afraid to ask for help, or you're afraid to ask mom and dad for help, or we get afraid. The stories that Jesus told today are stories to remind us that we don't ever have to be afraid to ask Jesus for help. Maybe teachers are scary. Maybe sometimes moms and dads can be scary. Sometimes big brothers can be scary. Sometimes pastors can be scary. But Jesus, you can be scary? You can. Let me see a scary face. Nice scariness. Dude, you are next to someone scary. I'd watch it. He's pretty scary. Sometimes we need to remember, in the moments that we are afraid, that we can ask for help from Jesus. Sometimes Jesus' help doesn't mean he's going to just show up like a superhero, but he may send someone to help. Kind of like when Declan got himself trapped by the pastor and Darren came. Sometimes Jesus' help comes through other people. Maybe sometimes you might be the help that Jesus sends to help somebody else out. Jesus is always ready to help you, but we need to be able to say, Jesus, I need that help. And then be ready for whatever Jesus has planned in the way he's going to help you. Fold your hands and let's pray. Dear Jesus, help us to remember to ask you for help. Amen. Okay, you can go back and sit down. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. So as we continue with the sermon series, A Journey of Faith. Today, it's kind of subtitled, Comes with Rescues, or sometimes Needs Rescuing. Sometimes we need to ask for help as we journey through this life and this journey of faith. We can't do it without help. Well, or maybe we think we can. Because if we are a guy, and I bet our wives or our significant others might remind us of this, sometimes we believe we know how to get places, even when we don't, without asking. Because if we just drive long enough, we will figure it out. And even if GPS is giving us directions, our answer is to turn down the volume because we know where we're going. Because somehow we have this internal compass which will write everything and I will get there. Even though there are gas stations or other people who might help, we would never think of using that resource. It's kind of like, guys, when your wife traps you in that question that you know if you answer, whatever it is, you're going to be wrong. Because you know your wives will not ask for help because you have to sense from this ESP husband sense that they need something. Because if they have to ask, well, if you loved me enough, you wouldn't have to ask. If you knew me well enough, you would just know. If it works for them, then women give us a break because it just know where I'm going. Right? You want the men to get help, so women, just start talking. We all have a way of going, I don't want to ask for help. I don't want to ask. Whether it's that you should know, or whether it's somehow I will divinely be directed, we are afraid to ask for help. For whatever reason. And that leads us right into where Jesus intersects with these church leaders in this chapter 15 of Luke. We have Pharisees and Sadducees who have convinced themselves that they don't need help, that they have themselves become the best educated, the most prosperous, and the most important people around all on their own and because of their brains, and they certainly don't need this Jesus guy helping them out. And in fact, they're a little ticked that Jesus is helping all those losers, the sinners and the tax collectors, all those stinky people who live on the other side of the tracks. Why is Jesus helping them? They don't even deserve to be helped. I don't need help. I'm not going to help them, and Jesus, don't do us any favors by helping them either. Just leave them out in the cold. And Jesus comes back to two stories about things that are lost. Because he knows probably better than anybody else in the room during those conversations that the people who are lost the most are the ones who don't even want to ask for help. When you actually believe that you can do it yourself, you are more lost than other people. Arrogance is the biggest blinder to how lost you truly are. And that's exactly the veil that the Pharisees and Sadducees had. They actually believed they were the smartest people in the room and that everybody else should bow down to their idea because it had to be good because it was their idea. And if you're ever plagued with that, then just look yourself in the mirror and say, well, I'm a Pharisee or a Sadducee. Because your ideas aren't always the best thing going, but God's ideas are. And here's how Jesus lays that out. He says, imagine some of you had 100 sheep, 99 were fine, and one gets lost. That one wandering sheep. Why did the sheep get lost? Who knows? Maybe it was arrogance on the part of the sheep, because the shepherd said, here is green grass, and he said, or she said, no, the grass over there is so much better, I'm going over there. Or maybe the sheep was just plain stupid and wandered off. Or maybe the sheep just wanted to go exploring. Whatever it was, there was some initiative taken by the sheep to say, I could be here, or it looks better over there. And I'm going to head that direction. And there are those tax collectors and sinners that intersected with Jesus that said, I could be here, but for a while, my life has taken me over here. And I'm playing fast and loose with my life because I thought it was going to be good. And I have no idea how to get back to the rest of the flock. And Jesus reaches out a rescuing arm and says, let me guide you back. And the shepherd finds the one sheep and picks the sheep up, puts the sheep on the shoulders and walks back to the flock and then throws a celebration. He doesn't show up to the sheep and says, it's that direction, kicks the sheep in the behind and says, get moving. He picks the sheep up and says, let me carry you right back to where you should be. It may have been arrogance or just plain stupidity or some kind of decision in life that gets you lost. Any of us are one bad decision away from being that wandering sheep. You may think, I have it all together. And by tonight, you may go, what was I thinking, and where is my life now? We are one decision away from needing rescue. And is that not ever more apparent today, 15 years after one decision after another led to thousands of people needing to be rescued, and rescuers running in and losing their life to save them? Isn't 9/11 the day we say, you know what? People get themselves into situations whether or not they know it, and they need to be saved. And people risk their lives to save people. Someone's one bad decision can get you way off track. But it's not just wandering that Jesus talks about. He talks about a coin. That coin didn't jump out of the bag and roll under the carpet. That coin didn't say, I hate my other nine friends, I am jumping ship. The coin didn't do anything but get lost. Life left that coin behind. Has life maybe left you behind? Maybe it's not as if you've wandered off. Maybe you didn't do anything to get lost, but you look around and go, whatever my life was, it's not here. And I don't know actually where I am or how I got here. I didn't do anything intentionally to get here, but here I am. And I feel completely forgotten and abandoned and forsaken. And does anybody notice I'm not connected? So you got two kinds of lost. Those that say, I'm out of here, and those that say, I didn't go anywhere and I don't know where I am. And in both cases, those lost items were searched for by someone who cared. A shepherd who said, I'm finding my sheep, and a woman who said, I'm finding my coin. And both times, there was celebration that the lost was found. And that's what Jesus was saying to the leaders of the church. It doesn't matter if you're left here and somehow life is moving this direction and you're lost, or you're over here purposely getting lost. I have come to say, you can't get yourself unstuck from here, and you can't get yourself unstuck from here. You need help. And the moment you say, no, I don't, we have left Jesus in the cold, because I can't do this without him. Jesus comes running in, and he grabs those that wander off. Jesus comes running in, and he scoops up those who feel like they have been forgotten and abandoned. And he says, now that you are back in my flock, let's celebrate. Because you see, what Jesus was saying to the church leaders was that we have a God who celebrates when the lost are back. Not a God that says, oh, you shouldn't have done this. Do this better next time. That was your mistake. We don't have a God that points out what you did wrong. We have a God that points out, you're back. So let's stay and move on together. You're back, and that's what matters. If we were more like that, it would be easier to ask for help. Because you know there are people in your life that the moment you ask for help, they're going to say, well, let me tell you all the things you did wrong. You don't think I know that? You get people like that, and all you want to say is, you know what, just stop talking, because you're a waste of my life. Now, Michelle has heard me say that, not to her. Because if I did, I would be sleeping someplace other than down the street. But there are people you know in your life that are a waste of your life because all they want to do is tell you what you did wrong. I know what I did wrong. Can you tell me something different? And don't give those people energy. Just don't, because God didn't give them energy. Jesus didn't say, oh, let's have the Pharisees tell you, tax collector, all the things you did wrong. Don't give them energy. It's God that brings you back to this place. It's Jesus that brings you back to the point of celebration and says, cleaned off, done. Let's walk together forward. Anyone that points out your faults in the past is a waste of your life. Because from this moment forward, if you're walking with Jesus, there is new opportunity, there is forward movement. Don't listen to what you weren't, but listen to what you will be in Jesus and move forward. That's what this parable is about. And anyone that wants to take you back to what you were is wasting the life that you have in front of you. And that's where these parables lead us. Because we are one bad decision away from being lost. And yet we're one call out to Jesus in order to be saved and put back in the flock. One bad decision that can be forgiven with one call to Jesus. And not a litany of all the things I did wrong, but a litany of saying the angels in heaven are rejoicing I'm back. And if they can rejoice, then you, brother, better rejoice with me, or you know what? I don't need to hear you. Because I'm back, and I'm with Jesus, and I'm going forward. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees said, well, if that's the kind of people you're gathering around you, I don't want to be around, because I want to point out to them that they're so much worse than me, because I never got lost. Really? Not necessary. Because Jesus says, once you're brought back, oh, wait, all of us were brought back through the waters of baptism. The only reason any of us are here is because of what Jesus did for us. There isn't one person in this room that isn't getting to heaven because of what Jesus did for them. And everything else they've done since then isn't getting them to heaven. It's what Jesus did 2,000 years ago. And what you did adds nothing to your entrance to heaven. So there's no room for arrogance like the Pharisees had. There's no room for pointing fingers. Because I'm not getting myself to heaven as your pastor. Jesus is getting me to heaven because of his life, death, resurrection, and his gift of baptism. So who am I to say, oh, you should do all these things, when really it's Jesus that's saying, here's what you need to do. Walk with me. Are you walking with Jesus? Because you know, Jesus ran into a burning building to get you saved. Jesus ran into a building that collapsed on him called the cross and crushed him to death to save you. Jesus was the first 9/11 rescuer in history that gave his life for a bunch of people that didn't even know they needed their lives saved. And it's you. And that's what he did. And yes, they're celebrating in heaven. Because people of God, when we cry out to Jesus, the angels go, now they've got it. Now heaven is open for them. Now they're back with the flock. And there is great rejoicing. There is not one person in this room or out there that Jesus didn't die for, that Jesus didn't go and look for. What separates them from those that know who what Jesus has done is whether they're willing to say, I need help. Declan would still be stuck, trust me. A 5-year-old, I can hold him for a long time. We'd still be here wrestling. He loves it. Thanks, Darren, for speeding things along, or it would be a long service. Someone needs to pull you out, and that someone is Jesus. That's where it starts. The Pharisees, the Sadducees, they backed away and said, if that's the way you look at things, we don't know that we agree with you. Because all of a sudden, you have just made us equal to the sinners and tax collectors. And Jesus said, bingo, you are no better, they are no worse. In me, you are equal. And that's where the story ends today, because here's a test, a little quiz. We have, truly, this is a quiz. Raise your hand if you know the answer. We've just done the parable of the lost sheep, the parable of the lost coin. We have this whole issue arising, I'm better than them, they're better than me. No, you're both equal. What story comes next? I'm so much better than them. He's so much lower than me. He ran away. He hung out with prostitutes. I didn't. The prodigal son. You see how this works? Now the Pharisees are getting themselves all worked up that I never did that. I never ran away. I never was like that. I should be treated. And Jesus says, let me tell you one more story. But that's for next week. You are rescued. The angels are rejoicing. Stand there in the celebration. that Jesus has called you to in your freedom. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, may that peace keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus until life everlasting. Amen. Having heard the word of the Lord, we will now